Thank you for coming again, and hope you will enjoy this last lecture. So, just a quick recap of what we did this morning. So we introduced peeling exploration, and we computed the law of a peeling exploration when the underlying map M is distributed according to the Boltzmann measure. And we saw that this peeling exploration is a simple Markov chain whose probability transitions are of two types. Once the edge to peel has been selected by the algorithm, then inside the hole that you are exploring, you may either add a new quadrangle, an event of type C, and this happens with this probability, or you may split the hole that you are exploring into two smaller holes of size 2k1 and 2k2 with this probability, very explicit numbers, and that totally describe the Markov chain. We saw that the transition probabilities for this Markov chain admit, in a well-defined sense, a limit as the perimeter L goes to infinity. And we introduced this limit and write B infinity for them. And we were in the process of proving this fantastic theorem that we have the convergence in law for the local distribution of Boltzmann measure of perimeter 2L towards the law of an infinite random quadrangulation of the half plane, so with an infinite perimeter, which is called the UIHPQ for uniform infinite half planar quadrangulation. For the specialist, actually, this is not the UIHPQ as introduced by Angel, because Angel was dealing with simple boundaries, whereas we're dealing with general boundaries. Okay, we started the proof, and I argued this morning that if we want a convergence of peeling process, this EI, we need to slightly modify this notion of explored map for local algorithm A. So this was this EI tilde, which is simply the map explored where you cut the very large face of degree L. And using simply this convergence of the probability transition, you can be convinced that under the Boltzmann measure with perimeter 2L, this Markov chain converges in law towards some random process here, which is a Markov chain. I should maybe stress the dependence in A here, because this Markov chain depends on the local algorithm A that you've chosen. Okay? Was that clear in your mind? Or is it now clear? Okay. And I said that we want to apply this to a particular algorithm, because I told you this morning that for some algorithms which are not suitable, this Markov chain is of no use to define a quadrangulation of the half plane. And we wanted to design an algorithm that explore a map around the origin, say step after step, discovering ball of radius 1, then ball of radius 2, then so on and so forth. Okay, so here is one such example. So A metric, the algorithm A metric. So if E is a map with holes, then pick A metric E is an edge on the boundary, say on the active boundary of E, so the union of the boundaries of all the holes, such that the vertex on the left of A metric E as minimal distance in E to the origin of the map of E among all vertices on the boundary, on the active boundary. Okay? If there are several choices, pick one deterministically. Okay? So this is a well-defined algorithm, meaning that if I give you a map with a certain number of holes, up, let me be a bit more precise, up, here is the root edge, then you will pick an edge on the boundary, on the active boundary, which is in a sense closest to the origin of your map. So to be precise, so that the guy on the left of your edge to peel, left with respect to the hole that you are going to explore, is minimal among all the vertices, whose distance to the origin is minimal among all vertices on the active boundary. Is that clear? Okay, so then what I claim May I erase? I would not dare erasing such a fantastic formula, so. No problem, you know. Cleaning is also my job. I have PhD students. They are not supposed to clean. Where was I? There. So my claim is, if you define the stopping time tau r as the infimum of all I such that the distance, the graph distance between the origin of the root edge and the active boundary of EI up, infimum pop pop pop, the infimum such that this is larger than r, okay? So that's the first time where all the vertices on the active boundary are at a distance larger than r from the root edge. Then, if you look at the explored map, then you can recover the ball of radius r in the map. It is not exactly the ball of radius r because of this. Imagine if this is, these two guys are at distance r, maybe these two are at distance r plus one, and they are not part of the map. They are not part of the ball of radius r. But you can, it's a measurable function of it. If I give you that, you have enough information to recover this. Okay, so let me erase this. Just simple, because you basically, this is a very good pointer, because if you have, if all the vertices on the active boundary are at distance larger than r, then in the map, if you want to keep a vertex or an edge which is at distance less than r from the root edge, it's already inside this guy. Okay? Well, then it's kind of simple now. So very easy claim, which I don't prove because it's really simple on the drawing. Then you just apply this convergence, and you want to say that EI at time tau r will converge in distribution as L goes to infinity, so here we are under PL, will converge in distribution towards roughly the same thing applied to this guy. So you consider EI, oh, sorry, also this lemma also works with a tilde there. So you take the algorithm A metric, and you stop this at the first time on this guy, that you've got this. And I claim that such a convergence is not always true. If you have a Markov chain which converges towards another Markov chain, and you have some stopping time there and the analogous stopping time there, if you want to say that your Markov chain stopped at this stopping time will converge towards this guy at the stopping time, what do you need to prove? You need to prove that these stopping times, they are not tending to infinity in some sense, because you could lose some information. Or you should prove that there, the stopping time for this chain is finite, if you prefer.
Because so far, it's not even clear that tau r is finite.
Here, yes, yes. But if it's finite in the limit, automatically they are finite there. So if you really want to prove everything, if you want to reassure yourself, you prove it's finite there and then finite there, but actually only this suffices. And this is, let me just give you a quick argument for that. So what does this guy in the limit? Okay, let's try to see how it works. You've got the root edge here. So the root edge, you've got the zero. Maybe you peel here. So this guy is at distance one. Maybe then you will peel either this edge or this edge, which are the two that are, there is a unique edge such that on the left-hand side, the vertex is minimal. So you peel this edge, So maybe you have a square like that, and maybe then you peel this edge, which make it identified with this, and then here you see that you've got 1, 2, 1, 2, 1. So in this case, tau 1 is achieved. There, after this peeling step, all the vertices on the active boundary are a distance at least 1 from the root edge. So how could tau 1 be infinite in this Markov chain? Well, it's infinite if, basically, that's the root edge. If you keep peeling and discovering maybe stuff like that, you identify this with this, and you keep peeling there, and you keep peeling, and so on and so forth, and you never stop. But I claim that this has zero probability. Why? Because at each step, when you peel, this edge in blue, when you peel one of this edge, there is a positive chance that you glue this edge to the one on the left. And if you do so, up, it's finished. You have surrounded the origin by vertices, so they are all at distance at least one. So if at each time you've got a positive chance to stop, that means that tau 1 will indeed be almost surely finite. Same kind of argument works to show that tau r is indeed finite under this model. Okay? So here, provided that. But this is true. Okay, so now if I want to finish, I just have to say that you can use, okay, here you have this under PL, and you know that from this you can recover as a measurable function, deterministic function, the ball of radius R in the map. Since this guy converges in distribution towards this guy, this Markov chain, this abstract Markov chain, you apply the same measurable function and you define, let's call it not B, but C, D, okay, DR. Apply the same function as you were applying here, and you define, that's the definition of DR. What I claim is that DR is a coherent system of balls, meaning that this DR for R bigger than 1, they define, or if you prefer, the union of all DR for R bigger than 1, they define an infinite map. Actually, it will be a map of the half plane. And the law of this guy, whose law you define to be this P infinity. Okay? And now clearly this diagram shows that the probability under PL that the ball of radius R is something fixed is converging towards the same quantity in the infinite setting. Hence, you do have convergence in distribution of this measure towards this one. Okay? So the theorem is proved. Seem puzzled. But the thing that is very interesting is that this guy also has a peeling process in a very similar fashion as this one. So let me just... Okay, maybe it's good to spend 2 minutes to take time to write it down, so that you'll see the difference. Okay, so here is the theorem. So you don't need to fix L now, you just fix a peeling algorithm, whatever, it does not need to be local anymore, a peeling algorithm. Then under P infinity, the law of the exploration EI exploration of M with algorithm A is again a Markov chain whose transition probabilities, I've been told that, where is Sanjay? Sanjay? Ah, you see, you taught me something very important. Transition probabilities, right? Well, let's have a vote. Who prefers probability transitions? And who prefers transition probabilities? Okay, okay. It's good to be against everybody. It's a Markov chain whose transition probabilities are given by almost same thing. If A of En is not End, then call Ln the half perimeter of, same thing, of the boundary to which this guy belongs. But notice that now Ln might be infinite. Ln might be finite or infinite. So Ln might be infinite. And then same thing, so if Ln is finite, if Ln is finite, same transition probabilities as there. See the theorem up there. And if Ln is infinite, what does that mean? That means that you are actually peeling on the infinite boundary. You want to peel that edge, as opposed to peeling an edge inside a finite hole. And there are two cases. Either you discover a quadrangle like that, and this event appears with probability B infinity of C, or second possibility, you may want to peel up something like that. That's the active boundary. And you want to peel that edge. And peeling that edge is identifying it with an edge on the same boundary, this infinite boundary. And so you split the infinite hole into two parts. In this case, it's an event of type. On the left-hand side, you've got infinity and then k on the right. Okay? And this happens with probability, which is just b infinity of g infinity k. And similarly, if you have a hole on the left hand side. Okay? Questions about that? So this infinite uniform infinite half planar quantangulation has a description in terms of Markov chain, very similar to the finite case, where except that there is just one hole of infinite length, otherwise everything works the same. Okay? In particular, what is nice is that when you're peeling on the infinite boundary, there is no L involved anymore. There, you see, the L is ln. There, the probability transition was depending on the path through the perimeter of the hole on which you're peeling. Whereas here, when you peel on the infinite hole, the transition probabilities are independent of the past. They are IID transitions, IID peeling steps when you peel on the infinite part. And we'll use that for the last chapter, chapter 5, applications. So we'll try to study the geometry of that guy through the peeling process. Let me just comment exactly as this morning. Actually, a remark to this theorem. It's a theorem, so it should be red with a little downstairs. Remark for this is that if you want to generate drawings of this guy, just use the Markov chain. So easy to sample parts of. Of course, you cannot generate the full map, but if you want to generate the ball of radius 100, just use the Markov chain. Okay. So the first application I want to make is concerning percolation. So let me define the setup. The setup will be phase percolation on the UIHPQ, meaning that first, we sample our underlying map according to this measure, P infinity. And second, using an infinite sequence of coin flips of parameter P independent, just have an infinite sequence of coin flips, IID coin flips. You color the faces of M in an IID fashion, black with probability P, with probability P, this P, and white otherwise. Actually, I'm a bit cheating because the boundary condition is a bit special. So to be honest, here is the boundary condition that we will have. You have your infinite map here. Maybe the root edge is, I don't know, somewhere here. Okay, let's not make this. It will confuse you. Up, the root edge is here. Okay, and then you've got quadrangles inside. So on and so forth. And you color all the faces of your map independently. This is black. You all agree? And this is white. Let me color code black and white. Okay, so maybe this one is black, and say this one also, say this one, okay? And since we will be interested in phase percolation, I will not be coloring the external face. Why? Because the external face is infinite, so if I color it black, then I have an infinite black cluster. The external face will always be white, but to start with, I will just imagine that on the left, on the right-hand side of the root edge, I have actually a two-gon which is always colored black, just to start the cluster somewhere. Okay, that's my boundary condition. So I have a two-gon which is colored black. So maybe I have up. Up, so on, maybe there. And I'm interested in the cluster, the black cluster of blacks at the origin. So the cluster of black containing this face. So what do I mean by cluster in phase percolation? If two faces are of the same color and share an edge, then they are adjacent. They are in the same cluster. But if two faces share just a vertex and not an edge, then they are not adjacent. Okay? For phase percolation, I really need a frontier between the two faces. Okay, so in this case, the cluster of the root vertex is this. Okay, so here is the theorem. We have So you first sample your map, then you sample your coin flips, which I will denote by eta I. These are the coin flips. And then you ask, is the cluster of the origin infinite? So what is this? This is just the probability that the cluster of the origin is infinite. But I expanded it just to explain something later on. And this is zero if p is less than 3/4, and is strictly positive if p is above 3/4. So that's an annealed percolation threshold for those who know percolation. But actually, from it, we have an easy, or easy, yes, it is easy. We can deduce a corollary, an almost immediate corollary. So if p is less than 3/4, then there are no infinite clusters in the model. Whereas if p is strictly above 3/4, then there is one unique infinite cluster. So it's really a percolation threshold, meaning that almost surely, if you sample your map and your percolation, then if p is below 3/4, then you see no infinite cluster. If p is above 3/4, then you see one unique infinite cluster. So it's really a threshold, a percolation threshold in the current sense in percolation theory. Notice that there is something interesting. For those who know, you know that if you take a graph, Z2, for example, you know, under my assumption, that there is a percolation threshold, that below which you have no infinite cluster, and above which you have an infinite cluster. For each graph, there is a percolation threshold. What this corollary says is that this percolation threshold is actually not a random variable. Yeah, it could depend on the map. Maybe you sample a map which has some percolation threshold, which is 3/4, then you sample another map, and it turns out that this new has a percolation threshold of 5, 6. No, this is not the case. They almost surely have the same percolation threshold, which is 3/4. Okay, so this corollary is really a quenched result. Okay, let's prove the theorem. You'll see it's effortless. For those who know, in percolation theory, computing percolation threshold is not a piece of cake. And usually for, I don't know if for Z2, phase percolation for Z2, we don't know what's the threshold value. It's a number. We don't know what it is. There, we can compute. It's a number, but we know what it is. Yes? Yeah.
How do we go from the theorem that is annealed to the corollary that is quenched?
You need a bunch of ideas. No. Maybe this will be part of the exercise session. It's a good exercise session, going from there to there. But really, the juice is there. But actually, when you see this, you think that this is much stronger than this. But actually, no. It is stronger, but not that much. Okay, so How are we going to prove this? You have a guess? Ah, somebody has been following the two lectures. Yes, we'll do that by peeling. We'll do that by peeling. So we just have to design the good peeling algorithm. Before doing that, let me just scare you a little bit and then reassure you. I will scare you because the peeling algorithm I will design will use the percolation, of course. But if you remember the second lecture, a peeling algorithm A is a deterministic function of the thing. So am I allowed to use the percolation on the map to drive my peeling process? It should be a deterministic function. So are you scared? Now I reassure you, yes, you can. Why? Because what we will do is we will actually devise a peeling, I will call it A face. And what you can see, what you can imagine, is that this algorithm depends on eta. Eta is the sequence of coin flip. So given eta, I give you a bunch of 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, give you that, you have a deterministic function. Okay? So what you may think is, oh, okay, instead of first sampling the map, then the percolation, what I will do first, I go to the other room, I sample my eta, there in my pocket, I have a big pocket, all my eta is there. I design my deterministic given eta peeling algorithm. Then I sample the map. It's independent of the eta. And so I am applying something deterministic given eta to my map. So it's totally legal. But because I have the right to do that, because I really split the randomness of the map and of the percolation into two independent randomness. Okay? Yes?
Do I need the algorithm that depends on eta to be local?
No, 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 no. Local, it was just when L was going to infinity. Now that L is already infinite, there are no local assumptions anymore. Okay, so what is A face? A face, yes?
Okay,
you are a little fox. Of course, yes. Yes, but what you can imagine is that the map, once you have the map, you label deterministically the face 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then you use your eta 1, 2, 3, 2 number. Okay, but this was on purpose put under the carpet not to scare everybody, but don't be scared. You're right, of course, but that's kosher. It's not well written in the lecture notes, but that's kosher. Okay, so what is the algorithm? The algorithm will work as follows. Assume that E has the following form. So we'll assume that E is some explored map. You may have holes. Oh, no. This is not black. This is not black, of course, because it's red. Come on. You did not see that? Aïe. You see my problem? Can you, in your mind, put a filter there? Everything this is green. okay? Because these are holes. Okay. So there is the initial boundary condition there. And we'll assume that E has the following form. So that's the infinite boundary. And this infinite boundary is made of some connected part where the faces there are green, black. It's going to be hard. That is a connected segment of black. And this is part of the cluster of the origin. And the rest are white faces. Okay? So if you wish, imagine that you have explored the map so far and that the cluster of the origin, if he wants to escape, he must escape through this boundary, this black boundary there. Okay? Given that, what is A, the edge we want to peel? A of this guy will be that edge, this one, the leftmost on the black boundary, by definition. That's my definition. Okay? So, and if not, then go away. Or do as you wish. It will not happen. We'll see. If not, or end. Maybe better put an end. What I claim is that if from the very beginning you are applying this algorithm, then these boundary conditions, this form of the boundary condition is preserved. So if you apply A face eta from the beginning, then EI is always of the above form. Okay? Let's check that. So first, initial condition. What is the initial condition? The initial condition, remember, what is E0, the initial map you want to peel, is just the root face, which in this case is infinite, so it's just an infinite line with, on the right-hand side, that's my infinite face, and on the left-hand side, my infinite hole. And I have my initial boundary condition, which is I have my face of degree 2 there. So to start with, I am indeed of that form. Okay? Now let's check a couple of cases. We'll not make them all, but let's see what happens if you have some connected segment of blue here. So you want to peel this one. And assume you discover some quadrangle. Then the active boundary is now this one. Then two possibilities. Either this face is white or it is black. If it is white, look at this, it is of that form because the boundary condition is white, 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 white. I cannot go here, white, 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 black, 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 white, 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 white. But this guy may also be black. And in this case, the boundary condition is white, black, white. Let's check another case, for example.
Also, I mean, you may end. In the first case, if it's white, then maybe you
have nothing. Yes, 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 yes. Sure, you may end, and then it's of the above form. But you will never, okay, typically you will not end that way. You'll see how. Okay, another case which may happen, for example, is you're here, you want to peel that edge, and this edge is identified, say, with that one. It's an event of type G infinite K. So that means that this drawing is actually looking like that. My green boundary, black boundary is here. Everything else here is white. And I'm identifying this edge, the edge I want to peel, with this one. But this new map is again of that form. Look at the new boundary condition. White, 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 white. Black, white, 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 white. Okay? So let's display the same thing in the lecture notes. Ah, no, it was on. Yes. Okay. Just to give you time to digest. We should maybe organize a race between the blackboards to see whether the first or second or third one is the fastest. I would bet on the third one, because it's the least used, so no. Who bets on the second one? Yeah. And the first? Yeah, nobody. And the third? Ah, we are only two? No, three? Up, up, lights, tableau. So you go around page, 80? No, 70? Yeah. Okay, so that's, black is black. So that's the initial boundary condition for phase percolation as I was displaying. And here are all the possibilities that may happen. Okay, so white, black, white, then you peel that edge. So either you swallow something on the right, so the black is a bit swallowed with something left, or you discover a face white, or you discover a face black, or you may swallow something on the left-hand side. So here you swallow a bubble on the left-hand side, but the boundary conditions are still white, black, white. Or, as Guillaume was saying, you may end the exploration by, for example, imagine that this edge is identified with an edge in the white part here. That means that all the black boundary is now away from the boundary. So the cluster of the origin, which is here, has no way to escape to infinity. So when the exploration ends, the cluster must be finite. Okay? So let's summarize this. Okay, I should tell you something to say that. The cluster is finite because each time I have a bubble like that, this bubble is finite. So the cluster cannot spread for an infinite amount in these finite bubbles. Why are they finite? Because these are distributed. You do the peeling inside each bubble, and it's the peeling of the Boltzmann map. Boltzmann map, they are finite. So lemma, the exploration stops if and only if the cluster is finite. Okay, we just have to see when does the exploration stop. So let's look to see that. Let's look at the process bn of the length of the black boundary in the exploration. So proof of the theorem now. So let Bn be the length of the black boundary in the exploration, in the A phase eta exploration. And let's look at how does Bn evolve. So Bn starts with B0 is 1. Why? Because of the initial boundary condition, you start with this. So the length of the black boundary initially is 1. Okay? And now let's see how it evolves. So what is delta of Bn? That's Bn plus 1 minus Bn. Could be different numbers. So this guy could be plus 2 in the case, for example, when you discover this, when you discover a face which turns out to be black. Then the boundary length make a jump of plus 2. Why? Because you remove that edge of the boundary, but you add 3. So it's plus 2. And this happens with probability. You need to discover C. You need to discover C. So with probability of event C times the probability that the face you've discovered is black, P. Or the boundary may make a jump of minus 1 with probability associated to the following event, where you discover again a face, but this face turns out to be white. So this happens with probability P infinity of C times 1 minus P. I will not make a list, but let's make one more. Delta of Bn might be minus 2k minus 2 if you are making a jump on the right-hand side, swallowing a bubble of size 2k. So that's the edge you wanted to peel, this one. And the edge you want to peel is associated with an edge on the right, located 2k further. Up, you glue, then you remove this part from the black boundary, and this part has length 2k plus 2. But of course, this has to be a supremum of minus Bn, the whole of Bn, because it may be that this black thing goes up to here, and okay, and so on and so forth. So when you do that, you realize that because of the remark I made a couple of minutes ago, that the peeling steps on the infinite face of the UHPQ are IID, you realize that actually the process Bn is nothing more than a random walk with IID increments, C above for the distribution, but killed and set to zero at the first hitting time of Z minus because you just apply this transitions. They are all IID, and the only thing you use on BN, the only thing in this transition which depends on BN is this supremum of minus BN, meaning that you apply these above increments unless these increments would make your BN negative. And then that means that BN is set to zero. So that's just a random walk with IID increments, started at one, and killed and set to zero when you hit the negative, the non-positive. Oof. Right, so how do you decide whether a random walk will hit the negatives or not? You just look at the drift, the expectation of this. So the expectation of the increment of this walk, you can compute because everything there is explicit. For example, remember that this is 2/3. And actually, you don't need to use the explicit thing. You just need to remember that the walk nu was centered. But anyway, so you can compute what is the drift of this walk, and you find that the drift, that the expectation of the increment is 2p minus 3/2. And so when you start a random walk from 1, if this expectation of the increment, if it's negative or null or 0, then you are sure that you will hit the negative. So you're sure that the exploration will end. So you're sure Who is member of the SMF here? Because I sent them a letter telling that next time I will not subscribe if they don't change this. Okay, what was I saying? So if P is less than 3/4, then this guy is negative or zero, and so the walk is oscillating or going to minus infinity, so you're sure to terminate the process, so you're sure that the cluster is finite, zero. Or if P is bigger than 3/4, this guy is positive, so there is a strict positive probability that the walk started from 1 never touches the negative. It may, but there is a strict positive probability that it doesn't. And in this case, the exploration never stops, and so there is percolation. There is a positive probability to get an infinite cluster. Okay? Right? So we'll do that in the exercise session, for those who want to do math in the exercise session. And I want to give you another example of application. And this other example concerns simple random walk. Let's go there. So example 2, simple random walk. So for those who are interested, you can do much more than that. You can compute anneal critical exponents. You can prove that there is a unique infinite cluster. You can study percolation using random walks in a very fine fashion using this description. So application number 2, simple random walk. So what is the setup now? Kind of the same thing. You first sample M according to this P infinity measure. And secondly, you perform a simple random walk on the graph, started from the origin of the map. What is a simple random walk? Simple random walk is just a process which starts there and then picks one of the neighbor of the origin uniformly at random, say here, and then iterate, pick one of the neighbor uniformly at random, moves there, then there, 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 come back here, up, come back here. Oh, I'm stuck, help me, I'm stuck. Oh, okay, no, okay, up. That's a simple random walk. You know, after 4 hours, and what are the questions you may ask about the simple random walk? Question of recurrence transients. Namely, will the simple random walk come back almost surely to its starting point or not? So, such question is not a piece of cake, and it has been proved very recently by Homer Angel and Gourab Ray in the room there with the beard and the glasses. Yeah, the guy smiling. So they proved that it is actually recurrent, but let me give you, I would need another couple of hours to show you the proof, provided that I couldn't understand it. But, I do. But let me give you a simple proof of the following proposition. Weaker, almost surely, the random walk visits the boundary infinitely many often. So in other words, the probability that the walk escapes inside the map and never comes back to the boundary is zero. That's weaker than recurrence, but that's already something. So let me show you a proof of that. Any idea on how to proceed? Wow, who said that? So how? Joe, you just peel. Yeah, I don't need to. Yeah, we'll peel. And we will peel along the simple random walk. So it's the last 30 minutes, so I am allowed to drop a little bit the level of rigor. So be kind. So here is the algorithm that we will use. Algorithm using the simple random walk. Peel when necessary for the walk to this place. What does that mean? Okay, I'll explain. Your initial condition is, as usual, an infinite face with an infinite hole, and your random walk is located here. So you want the random walk to move, but you don't know what, this is an unknown region, so you don't know where to move. So what you will do is you will discover the neighbors of this point until you've discovered all the neighbors, and you can perform one random walk step. Okay, so let's do that on an example. Say you want to peel this one, and you discover a quadrangle. Then you want to peel this one, and you discover that peeling this one makes an identification with this one. So you're back to this. Then you peel this one, for example, and you discover a quadrangle like that. Then you peel this one, and you notice that this one is identified with this one. So you have something like this. Okay, let me make a bit simpler for pedagogical reason. So you peel this one and you notice, oh, very nice, that this one is identified with this one. Up. And now, ladies and gentlemen, now you know all the neighbors of the origin. So you say to the random walk, oh, please, random walk, move. So the random walk was there, and she moves there. Oh, very kind of you. You are allowed to move one more, and she moves back there. Astonishing. Then, oh, yeah, I know your neighbor, so please move. And she moves there. Aha! And now, this is in the unknown region, so you perform peeling steps here in the neighboring of this guy until you discover the neighborhood and all the neighbors of this guy, thus enabling for one more step for the random walk. The random walk moves there, maybe here, up, up, then go here. You understand? Let me scare you. Is it a deterministic algorithm? It seems that I'm really using the random walk. Valentin, can we? Yeah. Actually, don't take zero ones, but take uniform between zero and one. Lebesgue between zero and one. And then say that if at step j, your random walk is here, and if you have j neighbors, then you use your uniform random variable to choose one of these j. There is still some dust under the carpet, because how do I number the j from one to j? Because it works. It works. You can decouple the randomness of the map and the randomness of the simple random walk into two independent randomness, so that this algorithm can be seen as a deterministic algorithm given some prerequisite randomness. Okay? Believe me. Then, okay, let me just draw the picture. Then what does happen if this happens, if the negation of this happens, if the random walk does not visit the boundary after some time? So let's not be precise. I like this. So you start here, that's your random walk, and you discover a bit the neighborhood, then the random walk moves. Then you discover a bit so that the random walks move a little bit more. Then you're here. Then you discover this. Then the random walks move. Then you're here. You discover this part. Then maybe the random walk touches the boundary. And then after this time, maybe she will never touch the boundary anymore. So it's here. You discover some neighborhood. Up, she moves. It's here. You discover the neighborhood, she moves, and so on. So that means that if after this time she will never hit the boundary, that means that what you're discovering is actually a submap that will never touch the boundary anymore. For otherwise, I'm a bit cheating here, for otherwise the random walk would never be at distance 1 from the boundary, but then if it's at distance 1, it will touch the boundary. Okay? So on the complement of the event of the theorem, then EI, the explored map with this algorithm, look like stuff like that, and you're always peeling at some point here, and when you peel this, you will never identify this with an edge there. Okay, so the thing grows like that, never touching back the boundary. Yeah, why not? So let's see that this is not possible. And to see this, let me, four hours and a half, and I cannot, one single lesson, that's the only thing. Yeah, incorrigible. Let's skip that and erase this. It's because I'm passionate by the story. Okay, to see that this is not possible, claim this is not possible. Impossible. Or probability zero, if you wish. To see this, so consider any peeling exploration of the UHPQ. So it's EI, and consider the following. I warn you, there is some dust under the carpet. So, the explored guy looks like this. You've got some holes. And you've got this infinite part. That's En, looks like this. Let's introduce a quantity which is the boundary change. So you got a certain number of edges there, which I like to call exposed edges, that are the edges of the boundary of En, which are exposed to infinity and not part of this infinite necklace. Okay, so this quantity is exposed edges, En. That's the number of exposed edges. And on the bottom, you've got what I like to call swallowed edges. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You count them twice if they are in the bottom part and totally lying inside. So minus swallowed edges. So that's for exposed, and that's for swallowed. Okay? Claim this guy is a random walk with IID increments of low nu. What a nice teacher I am. I planned that for at least 3 hours. Let's prove that. It's very simple. Very simple, because imagine that you were peeling there, for example. If you discover this, then, sorry, twice new. If you discover a quadrangle like that, then the net boundary change is plus 2, because in the exposed edges you add 3, you subtract 1, and you didn't change the swallowed edges. And this happens with probability nu of 1. Okay? Now let's see what happens if this guy is identified with a guy there. Okay? Let's see what happens. Up. It's something like that. So that where part of the exposed edges. Okay? That was my edge to peel. So if this is 2k, if such an event appears, then the net change in En is just minus 2k minus 2, okay, which is exactly, and the probability of this is exactly half of this one, because there is the symmetrized version. There, I said that I'm swallowing a bubble on the right, but I could have swallowed a bubble on the left. That's why I've got it twice. Last thing, last but not least, you may identify, say you're peeling here, and you may identify certain an edge with an edge there. But then what happens? Okay, let's try to make the drawing. Up, up. Then you add part. It's hard. I'm lost. Yes, I am lost. Again. Let's retropedalon. What was the drawing? I'm just hoping it's correct, huh? First. So I'm identifying with this. Okay, so let's do it step by step. Voilà. Much better. Yeah. Okay, so that was part of the swallowed edges before, and the exposed edges are there. Okay? So in this process, I swallowed this edge, this one, and all of this. So in this process, En, what I will subtract is this, because they are not part of the exposed edges anymore. And the swallowed edges, I am adding all these ones. There are no swallowed edges in my definition. That's why I was subtracting swallowed edges there. So it's perfectly okay. It's finished now. You see why? Because on this event, look at the swallowed edges and the exposed edges. Swallowed edges, they are fixed by definition, because this growing thing will not touch back the boundary after some time. Whereas the exposed edges, well, they are growing. But since orange minus green is a random walk with IID increments of low nu, remember that this walk is centered. The mean increment has the mean is zero. The mean of an increment is zero. So this walk with probability one will become negative. So the probability of this happening is zero. Okay? So I have 10 more minutes, and in 10 more minutes I will just describe what we can do. A third application of this. So this seems nothing, but actually for those who know, this already implies that the graph is Liouville, that is no bounded harmonic functions. So it implies some geometric properties for the graph which are of some use. Okay, so, okay. So buckle your seatbelt, Dorothy, because Kansas is going bye-bye. 10 minutes to do the metric exploration. It's gonna be Star Trek. So third type of exploration of application, metric. So here is the Roth theorem. Let me make it on a picture. So you've got this UIHPQ made of many quadrangles. You've got the root edge, the origin, and you may look at the ball of radius R. That's the ball of radius R. To be honest, that's the completed or the hull of the ball of radius R, because the ball of radius R may have holes in it, but I fill in all the finite holes in the ball of radius R. Then the theorem says that, roughly speaking, if you take the ball of radius R, then inside the ball you've got roughly R to the 4 vertices or faces or edges. They are of the same order, that this point and this point on the boundary, they are a distance along the boundary, if you travel along the boundary, R squared, and that the perimeter here, perimeter, is roughly R squared as well. So as R goes to infinity, what I claim is that typically, the ball of radius R looks like a random graph whose rightmost endpoint on the boundary is located R squared vertices on the right, similarly for the left, and such that the volume inside is R to the 4. And for those who are familiar with random maps, this growth rate is the typical growth rate for random maps, as shown by Gilles Chassin-Scheffer, Angel Rye, and many others after that. Okay, so let me try to describe for you how we could prove such a theorem, rough statement, using peeling. And you will have to believe me. But that's a theorem, so that's red. And the zigzagui. So proof. So the idea of the proof of the theorem is to use, and the idea is to discover the ball of radius 1, then the ball of radius 2, then the ball of radius 3, and so on and so forth. So let's imagine that you have discovered the ball of radius R. Then the peeling that you will do, the algorithm, will tell you, okay, now take this edge and peel there to discover maybe one angle like that. Then peel here to maybe identify this. Then peel here and so on, so that you are turning around the boundary of the ball of radius R that you have discovered so far. Okay, that's the peeling process, pop, 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 until maybe at some point here you have discovered some stuff here, and at the final step here, this edge, when you want to peel, is identified with an edge here on the boundary. So you have something of that kind appearing. Okay, you identify this with an edge. You may enclose a bubble here, and then you see that, roughly speaking, all the vertices that are here, it's rough, are now vertices at distance r plus 1. And then do the same. You start there, discover along the boundary, a layer there, until you have discovered a new layer, and then start again, and so on and so forth. Okay, So when you do that, there is one thing which is really important there and which drives everything actually. This is this variable here, which I call the overshoot. Because when you discover this layer, usually the last quadrangle here is not a quadrangle like that. Usually it is a quadrangle like that. And you have a couple of edges there. It might be. And believe me or not, so you know that when you do the peeling, probability to swallow, to identify this edge with that edge, k edges on the right, I told you this probability was of order k to the minus 5 half. But when doing such process, if you know a bit of renewal theory, of probability theory, this is called an overshoot. This is the first time some increasing random mode goes above some fixed level. And so typically this random variable has not the same tail as this one, but biased by an additional k. So this happens with probability k to minus 3 half. So it's a very heavy-tailed random variable. So now, if you believe in this, what you do is this process. So you discover the ball of radius 1, then the ball of radius 2, then the ball of radius 3, then the ball of radius 4, then the ball of radius 5, and this distance there, the number of edges there, they are roughly independent and having the law of this overshoot. And once again, if you know a bit of probability theory, if you sum R such random variable, then the sum of all these guys is of order R squared. Why? Because just the probability that one variable is bigger than R squared is the sum of k to the minus 3 half from R squared to infinity. This is roughly 1 over R, and you have R sample. So it's likely that at least one sample is of order R squared. But that it turns out that the sum of this guy is also R squared. Okay, so if you believe in this, then that's this part of the theorem. Second part of the theorem, I tell you, okay, this is R squared as well by symmetry. And this is also R squared. Why? Because remember, in this proof, this guy minus this guy is a random walk. So roughly speaking, they have the same kind of growth. So this guy is also R squared. Okay? But this random walk now is a random walk with low mu in the domain of attraction of a 3 half stable guy. And so this random walk after n steps is of order n to the 3 half, I tell you. Now, if this n to the 3 half must be r squared, that must mean that n is r to the 3. So that means that the number of peeling steps I needed to discover this is r3. Okay? And then, when I do that, I have many, many holes. And these holes must be filled in by Boltzmann triangulation. And the final estimate, which I will not tell you, is that if you have a hole of size L, then the typical number of vertices inside is L squared. So if you come back here, that's the perimeter. The volume after n step is not n to the 2/3, but n to the 3/4. Four-thirds. And if you plug this back there, then you get this r to the 4, and that's it. Thank you. Sorry for the black magic at the end.
So with this perfect timing, we have time for a short question, maybe? Or maybe everyone needs a break after the final. We'll keep the question for the exercise session and we thank you again.
Thanks.